Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to our presentation of Foreign Investors Council sentiment, Foreign Investors Sentiment Index. This is the second index which we are presenting, and thank you very much that you're coming. And I see a lot of the known faces who actually gave us those interviews on which we are based, actually, this index. Sorry. Can you hear right now? So, before we start, I would like to thank Agnes Sauka, who will give this presentation, and everybody who has participated as well. The next, currently, Crystal Sentiment Index is based on the situation which we have defined last year, somewhere mid-October, and presented to you. During the last year sentiment index, the three key areas were defined for Latvia. One was demography, another was education and innovation value-added services, and the third area which we have defined was rule of law, which was very important, very wide area containing all the insolvency administration issues, court effectiveness, and so forth. So today, Agnes will present us the sentiment index, which actually will look on the progress, more on the progress. And as the foreign investors, you have identified yourself that you believe that really structural reforms, big reforms, do take time. So therefore, we should be probably patient and not be too negative about what we will see, because this, the acknowledgement of the situation where we are right now, will give us a possibility to make change and to go forward. So this is the end of my opening remarks, and I would like to give the word to His Excellency Ambassador of Norway, who was really a big supporter for the Foreign Investor Council for this big job.
Thank you very much, Krista. A few words from my side. I'm here representing a government who cooperates tremendously with Latvia in securing its development and progress towards the model of the European democratic state that it is today. Improving business environment and climate is important contributions, and we are proud to be involved with this both through the EEA Norway grants and through other mechanisms and activities. Norwegian companies are large investors in Latvia. From 1991 until now, there are 323 companies registered here. More than 100 of them are very active in our local chamber and very active members and supporters of ESIS activities. It's obvious for everyone here that foreign investments are crucial for securing economic growth, creating jobs, social benefits, the confidence they transfer, and also the taxes they pay. One of the Norwegian registered companies was the largest taxpayer last year, paying 172 million euros in 2015 in taxes, which is a significant contribution. We all know there are still challenges ahead regarding the investment climate here in Latvia, but Latvia made tremendous progress in preparing and implementing required reforms in its preparations for the OECD membership. So progress has been made, work is still to be done, but that is also, the present government is well aware of this. We were all impressed, the minister, by last Thursday when you presented the reforms in the justice sector. We are moving in the right direction. We are proud to be part and supporting you on this. And we are also impressed by the work that we are planning to do, and we will also continue our collaboration with them. In fact, I don't think I've ever been in a country in the region where there is such a good and open dialogue between the government at political level, between the private sector, both domestic and foreign investors, and between the embassies on required and necessary reforms. It's an open and frank discussion, which is appreciated, it's impressive, and we hope it continues. And today is an important step and a part of this process. So I wish everybody good luck today, and we look forward to hearing the presentations on the progress made. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ambassador. I think, thank you for the good words. I think it is very important for us that basically we go through the presentation. Agnes, please, I could ask on the stage, and then we will have an open discussion. Today we have not just a presentation, we have a representative of the Minister of Justice of Latvia, we have state secretaries and deputy state secretaries from the Ministry of Economy and the Ministry of Finance. So I hope that today we will have a discussion about the problem, how and we could see the plan, how those problems would be triggered. So, Agnes, the stage is yours.
Thank you. Thank you, Zlata, Excellencies, Ministers, colleagues, and of course welcome to the Sentiment Index 2015 and 2016. So I have to admit that there's too much of slides actually and lots of information to share, so I will do my best to at least to brief you on the very main issues that we covered during this study. For those of you who are interested in reading and knowing more about this, we have compiled a report that consists of almost 100 pages, so long autumn evenings deserves some reading, and I hope you will enjoy at least some of what foreign investors have told us during this study, because it's not really my opinion or it's not some sort of academic stuff that we have covered in this report, but these are mostly quotes from investors, foreign investors, the ones who are actually making decisions whether to increase or not decrease investment in Latvia. So serious people to which opinions should I think be I'm sure should be considered. Well, before I start to the study, even though I'm the one who is standing in front of you, this is indeed has been a joint effort of many people and several organizations that have involved in order to make this FISIL sentiment index possible. These are FISIL office people, Marta, Alice, Girts, Zlata, of course, and many FISIL board members actually has involved, and also many companies has involved to share their experiences. SCB has funded, Deep White has helped to prepare different issues. Also, Embassy of Norway has played a significant part. So, you know, I could spend 40 minutes talking about supporters alone, but I think we will move forward to talk about the index. So, three issues that we have covered, as Lata mentioned. This is the second time we are talking about this issue, the second FISIL sentiment index. In the previous one, we identified several issues that are, according to investors' viewpoint, important for development and of investment climate in Latvia. This year we see, we actually are looking on whether investors see there is progress, what has been done, what still has to be, what remains to be done, and what are the potential, at least in the short term, activities that, according to investors, has to be implemented by the Latvian policymakers in order to improve or further improve investment climate in Latvia. So these are, this is the structure also of the report, these three issues that I will try to cover within the next 38 minutes or so. At the end, or in the middle, in the presentation at least, we come to the FISIL sentiment index 2015-16, which is sort of a summary of the main issues that has been covered within the report, so that those of you who don't have time to read 100 pages, you can have a look on one page and see overall assessment for investors in Latvia. So similarly, like previous year, we rely on key investors in Latvia, foreign investors in Latvia viewpoints. We interviewed the same 24 foreign investors on executive level, of course, as we did previous year, and we added another 8 foreign investors to this study this year. Basically, the example, if I may say so, is the same as we interviewed previous year, and I think the company names. I mean, you know all these companies. Approximately, these companies would contribute to tax revenues of Latvia something like on 10% level. So again, you know, these are really serious companies, serious opinions, which I believe should be definitely considered. And of course, we know that foreign investors in general, not only this year, but also all previous years, play an important role in entrepreneurship climate in Latvia. What is actually even more important to highlight, and you will see this from the presentation, that issues that are discussed by foreign investors are as important for development of entrepreneurship climate in general. So it's not just to improve for investment climate in Latvia, but actually you will see that we are in general talking about improving entrepreneurship climate in Latvia, which means higher GDP rates, higher economic growth, and so on. Right. So, so we move to the key results of the study. So the first thing we asked basically the same investors as we approached the previous year, whether in their opinion the investment attractiveness in Latvia has improved over over the 12th month, and well, unfortunately, we do not see a good evaluation. We basically asked to provide this evaluation on a grade 1 to 5. So those of you who lived in Soviet Union times, you remember 1 to 5, where 1 and 2 means fail, 3 means average, 4 means good, and 5 means excellent. So unfortunately, investors evaluate these efforts over 12 months not with a good grade. So something to think of. And we of course have several quotes that strengthens these opinions and explain why investors see this progress over the past 12 months. And exactly as Ambassador actually highlighted, it is important to understand that we're not talking about investment climate in general from early 90s to 2016. This is the 12 months period. So probably, and I'm sure that if you would ask about 10 years time, the evaluation would be completely different, right? So mind that we are talking about development issues, and being critical about development issues is something else than being critical about overall investment climate in Latvia. So this is very important to distinguish. In 2015, we presented the fiscal sentiment index in the Fiscal High Council meeting, and we had lots of ministers present who actually made a promise to investors that they will do their best in order to improve the investment climate in Latvia. So 1 year after, we asked investors, and we are going to ask this also next year and 1 year after, I hope, whether they see this promise has been fulfilled. And well, you know, we see that and we also see the distribution of the answers, that unfortunately not that many are happy with what has been promised and what has been fulfilled. Then in 2015 study, we identified the number 9 or 10 important areas according to foreign investors in Latvia that they see as a challenge, starting from demography, ending with the health system in Latvia. So what we did in 2016 study, we asked about each of those areas, whether according to investors' viewpoint, anything positive or negative has changed within these areas. And I will just do my best to very briefly go through all these aspects. Again, for those of you who are interested to read more, you will find more information with the quotes in the report. So demography, no, that's the short answer. Nothing really positive has changed yet. Investors admit that indeed demography is a long-term challenge, and they actually don't really expect that a lot of things would have happened. You can't change demography over 1 year, right? That is not really possible. So this is what investors of course also understand. Same is access to labor. Most of the investors would also claim that this is also longer term issue that still remains to be solved. What is not that positive, unfortunately, is that the majority of investors that we interviewed said that actually they would be happy to see at least some signs, some steps towards solving these issues, because if we don't start tackling this issue today, we can't expect that anything will change in 3-4 years. So they point to the need to be more proactive and really start working on this issue as soon as possible. And they don't really see that this has been done over these 12 months, unfortunately. Level of education and science, this is the aspect where opinions really matter and they also differ. We could say that approximately half of the investors see no progress that has been made. And there's one quote, there are many quotes like this who unfortunately are not very, very positive. Then again, there are also many investors that would say that actually the situation is not that bad as it is often maybe reported by media or perceived by by public in general, and also that the right directions has been made, especially in the medicine field, and also you know, there is increasing number of foreign students that are coming to study in Latvia, right? It doesn't mean that that everything is kind of good and perfect and nothing should be changed, but at least there are many investors that see substantial progress that has been made still. Quality of business legislation is something that was heavily emphasized previous year, and this year unfortunately there were only 3 out of 32 who said that there is something, at least minor positive issue that has happened towards this improvement of business legislation quality in Latvia. Majority see that it is indeed still an issue that should be solved, and the next thing is the quality of the tax system, and this is according to this study at least this seems to be even bigger concern like it was previous year for investors, because if investors were talking about the quality of the tax system previous year, then this year they increasingly talk about that. And they actually said that most of them would say that it is as bad as it was. Some would say that it has even become worse, unfortunately. I mean, you see the quote, I don't have much to say here. There are no improvements. The situation has been the same for many years, right? So showing that according to many, at least for investors, it's not just about 12 years ago, it's about maybe more than 12 months ago. The lack of predictability of taxes and also tax collection administration. These are probably the main issues that has been emphasized by the policymakers, by the foreign investors. And in similar way, then when talking about the quality of legal system, also when it comes to improving or dealing with the tax system, investors basically highlight the need for more in-depth analytical approach when these changes are made. So the policymakers don't do something that might look quite good from today's perspective, but then regret this after 4 years, which seems to be the case with microtax, for instance, and many other initiatives, or insolvency issues that are dealt maybe a bit like that, or also solidarity tax, right? So this is all taken together. Investors basically point to the same thing that we academics are talking about, that when we are facing these development issues and when we go for development, the questions we deal with are more and more complicated, so that requires much more analytical work to be done in order to make these decisions. Otherwise we might really increase the chance to regret these decisions in 3-4 years, maybe sooner. See, on these are again a few quotes just to show the sentiment of our investors when it comes to the quality of the tax system, right? Then the next issue, and I think this is the most positive issue that I see from the report from this survey, and I was really happy to see this trend indeed, is that most of the majority of the foreign investors that we interviewed actually see that the communication with the government has improved. They say that the government has become more open, more accessible. Government involves in discussions, and I can't agree more to what has been said in a speech by Ambassador that this is indeed a nice society in terms of communication about raising issues, about discussing them, not being kind of reluctant to admit some problems, understanding that there are challenges if we want to go where we want to go. Still, and of course, I mean, you know, we know that these are not machines. I mean, we are all people, and also ministers or policymakers and entrepreneurs are humans, and a lot of issues depend on the person for investors meet in the ministries, and here the quotes show actually that. There are many quotes that are positive quotes about Ministry of Finance, or Minister of Finance, or Minister of Economics, or Minister of Justice. So people highlight kind of the role of these personalities in shaping this communication. Yeah, of course, I mean, some would still say that, okay, but we still hold a lot, it's positive, yet we don't really yet see the action. So first step, communication, right? But then the action is something that they would maybe need to see a bit more. Well, unethical or illegal behavior, this is something that we talk in conference on the shadow economy in May, and we will not talk much about this. That's too sensitive and too close to heart topic to me. So again, I could spend another 48 minutes talking on this, but yet, this study shows that in general, we don't see any improvements in this area, unfortunately, and investors see this as a major problem. Some think it's worse, and only there are some positive opinions, but not that many, really, just a minority have to say something good. Right, I mean, there are, again, a few quotes that would highlight. Next is uncertainty, and uncertainty is something I already mentioned when I talked with the tax system. And here, we distinguish this phenomenon because it's not just with the tax system, it's also with many other aspects that we've been and will be talking about. And unfortunately, uncertainty seems to be one of the really major issues in all areas that investors unfortunately see. I mean, there is for instance one quote. We did these interviews, was I think in September, and the investors basically said, well, you could ask this question in 1 month's time when the budget process will start, and then we will see lots of very, very negative issues going on. Well, I can imagine why then this particular investor said it, because we all remember what happened last year with the budget process. I have to say that this year the budget process, to me at least, looks much, much better. And it was, I don't think it has really, these bad expectations has been fulfilled by these particular investors. But see, I mean, of course, people, entrepreneurs, investors, remember what has happened 1 year ago, and they will still remember, and they will be cautious about these issues, which means not just what is done on a policy level, but also how it is communicated by media, by social network, you know, many ways how to communicate various issues these days. The court system in Latvia, and it's good that we have a Minister of Justice who is listening to this presentation. Again, this is the sentiment of our investors, but you know, we again see, we actually see also it's not really straightforward answer. Something like in between. Half say there is no really progress. Some say that luckily they have never had experience with courts, which means that it's not their experience they're judging, but what they've read in media and what they kind of think they know, or maybe they know from someone. So it's also the prestige of the court system, or the way again that the issues are communicated. And one third, I mean only one third, or as much as one third, it depends how you look on this, still also see positive tendencies, right? So again, it probably this issue in as well as many others, maybe, again, would deserve much more in-depth exploration. And this is what official work groups kind of do. And you will, you know, if you follow what FISL does, you will see these issues being tackled in more depth. But in general, right, so we see some positive, some negative things here. Some quotes, for instance, one investor, at least, is not happy about how long court hearings take too much time spent. Education training of judges, again we come to the personality, we come to this education innovativeness component which also investors see as a major area, and so on and so forth. Yeah, and here are some positive trends also that has been highlighted. And finally, the healthcare system, that's kind of the last aspect we've been looking on. And unfortunately, when it comes to the healthcare system, for investors are not at all happy. They actually say that first, there are no improvements. Second, okay, healthcare system works, but we have to pay for that, and we don't know why, and we don't know why so much, and you know, these type of issues. Well, there are some who actually believe it has become worse and terrible. Is word that is sometimes used when talking about healthcare system in Latvia, and just three of all these investors talk about some positive aspects, but also these quotes actually reflect that there was something positive that has happened either with them or with their relatives, right? So it's not, again, does anyone know how much time do I still have? Because I don't see any clock and... Oh, 25 minutes. In 25 minutes we can do everything. Okay, 15. Even better. Then, as I promised, so it's kind of the summary of all what I've just been talking about, the official sentiment index. And again, without a longer explanations and very, very long in-depth discussions, well, we basically see that, well, it's somewhat tricky. We evaluate this from 1 to 5, and then we see these ups and downs in 0 point level, which, you know, does not really say much. But in general, what this slide shows is that according to opinion viewpoints of our investors in Latvia, the situation overall has remained the same. In some aspects, slightly more better situation. In some aspects, slightly a worse situation. There is one aspect that we actually put under quality of business legislation, which is not really business legislation. We talk about tax system, and we compose this disaster from several indicators. But if I would have these distinct kind of the feed, distinct aspects that are forming some of those aspects, then we would say that the quality of tax system, which was evaluated 3.1 last year, it is now evaluated 2.8. So it is. This is probably one of the indicators that is really decreasing, and we can show this even when we measure this from the aspect from 1 to 5. The good things is efficiency of labor, despite of various international indicators that show that how productive employees in Latvia are. I've been highlighting this in different interviews that I don't trust myself this judgment, because at least all of my friends and colleagues, they work over like over their limits very often, and I can't believe this can be very productive. So, you know, we all work like a lot, and what we see here is that actually also for investors, similar like previous year, they would say that, okay, it's not that bad actually, that unproductive labor force. This is the productivity level we are happy to get for the price we have, but we would like to have more of those, right? So, which is sometimes maybe not easy to achieve. And also the overall standard of living in Latvia, there's probably a reason why for investors live in Latvia, so it's not also that bad. From 1 to 5, 3.9, I think it's very well. And it has also increased from 3.4 previous year, yet we have to consider that there are few new investors that came in, so maybe those are more positive, maybe less, right? So it's somewhat tricky, but still it's still overall it's not a bad judgment. The big rather big part of the report consists of answer to the question, what do you think about further investment plans? Do you have any further investment plans? And of course, investors answered this question and gave a lot of comments and insightful ideas. Well, what we see is that from 32, 16 said that yes, in one way or another, they are to increase the investment. 10 say that no, for different reasons, and we will see this in quotes. And 6 are really undecided. And again, here we are talking about existing, or in general, in this sentiment index, we are talking about existing investors. We don't know about those investors who maybe did not come to Latvia, or what were the reasons why they did not come. It's just very, very complicated, if not impossible, to actually to tackle this issue. Because some of them might have decided to make investment in Poland, for instance, and then it's still sensitive to go because they might deal with Latvia in one way or another. You know, it's kind of the business. Ethics maybe which will not make them talk about that sensitive issues. So as I promised, some quotes. Those who say yes, some say it's a strategic plan. It depends on the business environment, of course, but this is kind of natural growth that they have planned and that they are going to fulfill. some people, some investors say that actually they are about to increase their investment substantially, despite of number of negative things that I had to talk about in the previous slides. So again, same thing. When it comes to now, we need stability. Clarity about development perspectives, some other issues, and then some are really not decided, and it is really analysis in most cases that is ongoing. Availability of labor and cost, anything that makes us more competitive. This is just one quote here, but basically it goes through the opinions of most of the majority, at least, of investors who are thinking about whether to increase investment or not. So that's to be very, very, very short. This is actually, I think, a very positive slide, because we remember this investment grade 2 or 2.3. Yet if we ask investors whether would they recommend investing in Latvia to friends or business partners, then unless they don't like their business partners and friends, which I would not like to believe in, it's 3.3. It's not perfect, right? But it's better than 2. Yes. So there is still some reason, and we can guess what is the reason after this negative assessment, when actually for investors say that okay, you know, it's maybe not that bad, and we would welcome also, we'll be happy to see other investors here. And finally, the last thing is, of course, I mean, the last aim of this study was to criticize someone or to find some negative aspects. Quite contrary, FISIL always has emphasized that they are instead in constructive dialogue, and this is how we framed the study. We asked for several issues that could be improved, but something that we emphasized was, okay, so you identified in 2005 the critical issues. You assessed the development within these 9-10 critical issues this year. Yet, when we will present this index in 1 year's time again, and I hope you're going to do this, then what are the main things that really cannot wait that you would emphasize that the policymakers in Latvia should not postpone and should really do like from today, unless it has happened already? And then again, we had several short-term activities crucial for the development of investment climate that were emphasized by investors, and we made a nice pyramid. Again, not to go very deep in these issues, the improving the performance of NAB and State Revenue Service. This is something that investors are not happy with. Better functioning public sector communication, still issues we heard, good positive trends, yet there's something that should be improved, and according to the viewpoint of investors. And there were investors who talked about issues related to renewable energy, and we know, of course, why, because of this regulation and ongoing discussion. Then, which is come upper to the ladder that gets kind of more and more important, law enforcement and the court system, especially law enforcement, is an important aspect according to investors, because indeed many investors say that the legal framework is in place maybe, but not always when it comes to the Sharia economy, for instance. Not there are too many people who actually sit in the jail if have been cheating too much, for instance, and so on and so forth, right? So this is an issue. Sharia economy, corruption, tax evasion, again, something that has been emphasized and is continuously being emphasized. And education and development, of course, because most of the issues that we are talking about here depends on the people. And of course, the better education, the less we can expect these type of problems, and the higher we could aim in our development plans, because we, right? These are people who will implement this. Some quotes, the court system needs to be improved. Fix the problems, labor force, invest in quality. That means improving educational system. Then we go to the tax and legal system, something that has been emphasized previously in this presentation, is like constantly emphasized by investors in this report at least. And the implementation of policies, kind of long-term more analytical thinking, again something that I try to highlight, but the investors think that these are issues again that should not be postponed and it should be very much dealt with. And again, here are some quotes, like improvement of the legal system is crucial, solid system, commercial law, functioning of the courts, ensuring the safety of investment, both foreign and local. Should be clarity about the tax system, where the heck we are going, one investor asks. We need to have a vision about where we go and which sectors area Latvia wants to see for investment and proof points for government actions. Some investors highlight that, okay, we live in a greenhouse having these EU funds, but the party is over and what then? And that's, I think, it's a very important question to raise and think about. Municipality reforms, something that also there's quite a discussion about this issue, and cutting bureaucracy is another thing that is often highlighted by investors. And finally, we come basically to what we discussed last year, what we emphasized as a number one issue also last year, is demography and availability of labor. And again, investors understand that there is no way you can deal with these issues or solve them in 1 year's time. Yet, if you won't start, the policymakers will not start more seriously work or more proactively work on this issue, then nothing will change also in 5 years. Again, a few plots. Labor issue should be on the top of the list. One investor says nothing is changing. Some say that, okay, let's bring them from elsewhere. And we've been discussing implications and potential of smart immigration policies, which is, of course, an issue that can't be viewed just from positive side. There are also some negative consequences, potentially. But again, they would like to see more discussion and action in this area. Demography, complex issue. There's no one activity that should be implemented yet. Again, it's this analytical approach that investors would kind of require and would like to see. And finally, we ended with these interviews by saying, okay, thanks for sharing all the opinions and we highly appreciate it, but now we're going to present this to the wider audience, but we also want you to read a short story, nice short story to the Prime Minister of Latvia, in essence explaining what is your wish, what is your suggestion for what could be done, what still remains to be done to foreign investors in Latvia. And we are of course keeping our promise for investors. Council will give this nice envelope. It's not really envelope, it's going to be an envelope to the Prime Minister of Latvia to express viewpoints of foreign investors. Don't tell anyone, but I can whisper that what is covered here is also available in the report. So it's another trigger for you to look for a report and at least look at this section. It's not kind of polite to read other messages, but in this case I think Prime Minister will not mind this. So thank you so much for listening, and I'm looking forward to this. I hope that it's going to be a fruitful and interesting discussion. Yeah, I also need to take some questions if there are some slots in line for me.
Thank you for an excellent presentation. I have some issues with the methodology that was presented. I'll just mention a couple of them for your response. Some issues are long-term, as you correctly mentioned, like demography. But you talk in terms of 1 year, has it improved since last year, and you really can't do that. My thought would be that if you look at it on a longer term basis, like 5 years, or in some cases 20 years, then you see that the Latvian population has gone down by 20%. That's huge. That's the equivalent of US losing 60 million people. So perhaps in terms of that, you could ask the question, in your methodological way to increase rather than 1 year to 1 year. The same would go for education or for healthcare. It's really difficult to say how it really improved since last year. But if you take a longer term perspective, I think that would be the case. Same with labor availability. There's a huge difference, diversity between regions where labor is really short and say Latvia there when there's a lot of labor. So I think if you make those distinctions in your report, I think it would be a little bit more, would bring more clarity to the people, to the investors, and perhaps the government. But that's a way forward, as you have put it. All right, I'll stop here. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for so much for raising this issue. It's indeed very, very crucial because, you know, in academia they're saying crap in, crap out. So if there is no proper methodology, there can't be proper results. Overall, being academic, I would strongly argue that you're right in terms of your assessment. But maybe not really in this case. And the reason for that is that in 2015, We did basically what you said that we should do now, and we got assessment, and unfortunately the main conclusion and that was also the question from the journalists in the press conference is that, you know, guys, come on, why do you waste my time? I've been listening to these issues like for 5, 6, 7 years, all the same discussions, all the same problems, and basically all the same people being presented in the audience. So why do you, I mean, Mr. Sokol, why are you wasting my time? What are you doing here? And that is exactly the point. We are talking about these issues, about, I've been talking about this for a second year, right? But many people before me has been talking about these issues for too long. And these are the same issues. And of course, at some point, there are developments. In some aspects, there are less developments. So this is what we tried to capture in the previous year. And what we achieved, we got a list of issues that, despite of positive achievements, are still potential for improvement. And this year, we have slightly different aim. So, and this aim will remain for also the coming years. So we measured the temperature last year, and now we see how the temperature is changing, or what has happened, like previous year. So it's that's why the emphasis is on progress, what has happened, on what has happened 12 months ago. So I hope this answers your question, the first part of the question. Another thing, of course, as you said, that there is indeed diversity. Riga, regions, so on and so forth. As much as we can, we try to capture these issues in the report. Maybe not on extent that is sufficient. I have to admit that this report gives a very broad and overall assessment and picture on the issues we're talking about. And this is the key aim of this issue. All these issues that are mentioned here, at least the main ones, are then, before and after, the subject of work by various special working groups that will go in depth and look on various aspects to try to understand why the overall opinion is the way it is here, not always positive. Right. So there are different purposes for different studies and different methodologies. This one serves these exact purposes, and of course we understand that. Then you would have to spend very long evenings, like reading 400 pages instead of one.
Sometimes we see that the statistics shows that unemployment among the youth, namely between 18 and 34 years of age, is quite high in Latvia. Do you see any solutions in this regard? Do you know how to bridge that gap?
Oh, I mean, I don't want to pretend to be an expert in areas that I'm not expert in, I'm sure not expert in this area. I just know from other experiences, I know I've been talking with colleagues in Slovakia or Slovenia, that they've been trying to solve this youth employment and with very powerful methods, and they ended up having a major problem for general employment. So what I'm saying is that once you start prioritize one group, Could it be best ages elderly people? Could it be youth? Could it be unemployed? Could it be someone else? The experience from other countries, neighbor countries, actually show that you have to be very careful not to look on the whole context on how giving privilege to one group will or will not change the whole employment situation in Latvia. So that's basically all I know about these issues, and I'm sure there are many experts that know this much better than I do.
In terms of investment, Latvia is, and foreign investors actually are mainly or partly sponsored and by the European Union. And the European funding is going to end or reduce dramatically in the short term. So have you been measuring this, or does it, you know, is it included in your statistics yet?
No, we are not measuring it, no, I don't believe that for investors, investments are funded by anyone but their own companies. What is funded by EU is various programs in terms of development of the competitiveness, infrastructure, innovativeness. That's where we can say thank you to the European Union, but not because of the foreign, which of course might influence the overall climate. But we have not measured, and I don't think ever anyone has measured what, or at least tried to model, predict what will happen when this EU funding is over. And this is what actually for investors highlight and pay attention to the policymakers to be aware that that you know the party is soon to be over. If you have still time for one question. One. Lata says one. No? Yeah, okay.
I must confess, I wasn't very happy with your answer. When we talk about expanding the perspective of demography or health or education, I suggested that maybe 3 to 5 years might be more appropriate than 1 year. And I didn't quite understand why you thought still 1 year was good, because I mean, how does someone who's the CEO of a company here know the difference from last year to this year, unless he's a demographer or a professor in demography?
Well, my answer was that we looked on this perspective previous year, and now we continue with the shorter perspective this year. So what you are asking us to do now, we did previous year, so there is another report, the previous report, which we could share. I mean, it's available where you will see more long-term perspective. Otherwise, we did not want to do the same thing that we did already last year. It would be boring for those of you who attended previous year.
You mean that's the criteria, whether it's going to be boring for us or not?
No, I mean that we did what you asked the previous year, and now it's kind of step further, involving shorter time perspective. But we talked about the longer term perspective previous year, and building on this longer term perspective and building on the promise of the policymakers to tackle these issues that has been for a long term a challenge. We tried to say, okay, you know, it was a problem for 3-5 years, okay, identified, so now what has happened, whether anything has happened over these 12 months. I hope I made it more clear, sorry for.
Another point of clarity, of course, would be when you say ask people if they want to invest here or not. How do we know if they don't want to invest anymore here? Is it because there's no need to, or because they don't like to be in Latvia, or you know, what are the specifics for why they don't want to leave? All we know from that presentation is that they don't want to invest, but we don't know why. I think something like that would be clear.
Yeah, and that's the reason to one of the reasons maybe to look in the reports, because in 40 minutes. I could talk about each of those aspects, but what is important is that there are lots of theorists, and that I don't want to start guest lecturing here. And it's also faculty of law; it's not faculty of business, right? So I am not allowed to lecture here. But in general, there is a strong link between perceptions and attitudes and actual behavior, and we see these perceptions and attitudes within these reports, and that most likely will influence this actual behavior. And knowing the trends of investment that are not that positive currently, at least if you look on half of the 2016, we should very carefully and take into consideration what these investors say. Yeah, to that I can conclude. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Magnus, thank you very much. I think it was a very interesting presentation. We all could probably debate about the methodology used, but I think what is most important is what is our feeling and what is our perception about being in the business or having the business department here in Latvia. And the perception is made on a lot of the things. One is how it is presented, and therefore now today we have the representative from the government who will be talking about the areas which we as a foreign investor has mentioned as a very important area for us. And we really believe as a FITSE that this without the mediation discussion about the milestones and the road plan for the next 6 months is really great in terms of building trust and understanding what is happening. So saying that, I would like to invite here to the panel Minister of Justice, Gintars Stanksnič, State Secretary of Ministry of Economy, Jūris Steinka, and Deputy State Secretary of Ministry of Finance, Irma Šumatiņš. The plan for today's discussion is, first of all, to give maybe a room for each of the panelists to say a few words about what is the plans of their ministry in terms of the future activities, and then I will open the floor to you for the discussion and questions and answers. Minister?
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, we have adjusted some interpretation also out of the Union State language. Jā, vispirms jau paldies, paldies Arnim Saukam par šo pētījumu. Atklāt runājot, es tajā metodikā redzu vienu pakāpu augstāk par globālās konkurencspējas indeksa metodiku. Bet atzīšos atklāt, protams, Doing Business man bija, Pasaules Bankas Doing Business pētījuma metodika man bija un būs tas galvenais rādītājs. Šajā pētījumā mēs skaidri redzam, ka gada laikā nekādas būtiskas izmaiņas nav bijušas, ja nu vienīgi tiešām šīs nodokļu jautājumus nedaudz krities uz leju izglītību un tur vēl vairāk punktu. Bet kopumā ņemot, mēs redzam, ka tas pētījums svārsās ar trīniem, un tā ir tā vidējā atzīme, ko ārvalstu investors visām tām nodzerēm ir lielos vilcienos runājot, ir ielicis. Tā ir tā vidējā atzīme, kas ir, nu, teiksim, 10 vai izskalā, tas būtu 5 mērķis, te varēja vērtēt no 1 līdz 5. Protams, man ir liels gods šeit pārstāvēt tikai vienu desmito daļu no visa pētījuma, jo arī mums klāt pie tieslietām ir pielikt nodokļi, bet jebkurā gadījumā paldies ārvalstu investoru padomei, un man svarīgi ir pateikt to, ka mums ir cieša sadarbība ar investoru padomi arī ikdienā, gan visās, praktiski visās darba grupās, kas skar tautsaimniecības attīstību, gan arī jau augstākā līmenī, protams, ar to forumu, kurš katru gadu reizi gadā notiek valdībā, tātad, ka visi investori pulcējas kopā ar ministru prezidentu. Ko mēs esam ieviesuši jaunu? Jaunums ir tas, ka mēs esam uzsākuši jaunā formāta tikšanos. Tā ir tieslietu ministra tikšanās ar OECD dalībvalstu vēstniekiem. Pirmā reize bija šī gada 1. decembris, Un vēlreiz lielu paldies visiem vēstniekiem, var teikt, ka jūs piedalījāties un aktīvi piedalījāties. Un lielu paldies arī ārvalstu investoru padomē, kas arī demonstrē savu skatu no malas un savu vietējumu, kā vajadzētu notikt attīstībai tālāk. Tas mūsu 1. Decembra sanāksmes pamats secinājums, kas arī izskanēja daudz, bija tāds, ka no valdības darba vien mēs nevaram gaidīt labu rezultātu, ja parlamentā būs cilvēki, kas bloķēs mūsu reformas. Un tāda situācija ir ar reformām maksātnespējas jomā, kuras regulāri tiek bremzētas un bloķētas tieši parlamentā. Un pēdējais mēģinājums bija juridiskā komisijā, kur Ingūnas Sudrabas un Gunāra Kultera priekšlikums noņēma amatpersonas statusu administratoriem, tika atbalstīts. Šodien koalīcijas sēdē mēs pat uzlēmsim. Un mēs ļoti ceru, ka vienotība nolēmas, kas ir vienīgā neizlēmas, ir faktīši šobrīd, ka nolēmas, ka administratoriem amatpersonas statusu ir jāsaglabā, jo tas, ko piedāvāja konkrētie deputāti, respektīvi izņemt administratorus no knāba un no vidas stingras kontrolas. Tas nozīmē, ka tā skēmošana, kas bija pirms 2-3-4 gadiem, ka tai atkal būs zaļā gaisma un atkal varēs visu turpināties, jo ar to, ka mēs pastiprinām maksātnespējas administrācijas kapacitāti, ar to ir kā maz. Tieslietu ministrijas pakļautībā vai pāraudzībā nav nevienas izmeklēšanas iestādes. Tāpēc mūsu sadarbība ar valsts policiju, ar iekšlietu ministriju, ar knābu, ar finanšu ministriju, ar valsts ieņemu dienestu ir jau sasniegusi jaunu pakāpu, un mēs to darām kopā ar ārvalstu investoru padomu. Šis kompleksēs darbs arī ir bijis tieši mūsu virzībā uz OECD, un, kā zināt, mēs esam pilntiesīgi 35. Dalībvalsts, un, protams, iestāšanās procesā mums bija daudz mājas darbu un arī pēc iestāšanās. Un svarīgākais, kādā jaunā tiesiskā telpā mēs šobrīd esam, tātad ir ievērojami paaugstināti krimināli sodi, naudas sodi, līdz 10 tūkstošu minimālām mēneša algām fiziskām personām un līdz 100 tūkstošu minimālām mēneša algām juridiskām personām. Tas ir 3,8 miljonu eiro vienam un 3,8 miljonu juridiskām personām. Protams, juridisko personu atbildība ir arī ļoti labs preventīvs līdzeklis tam, pret ko OECD īpaši iestājas pret pārobežu kukuļošanu, kas ir izplatīta gan OECD valstīs, diemžēl, gan arī trešajās valstīs, kuras nav OECD dalībvalstis. Un trešais, protams, svarīgākais, tā ir nežēlīga cīņa pret naudas atmazgāšanu. Šajā cīņā Tieslietu ministrija tiešā veidā nav iesaistīta, taču mēs visos iespējamos veidos atbalstam tās iestādes, kuras to dara, gan prokuratūra, gan Finanšu kapitāla tirgus komisija, gan arī, protams, policija. Jāsaka, ka mūsu padarītās šī gada laikā, es tagad tādu garu pārskatu un atskatu nesniegšu, vienkārši pavisam īsi minēšu tātad. Ievērojami samazinājušies pēdējo 3 gadu laikā tieši tiesvedības termiņi. Tad noteikti ir jāņem tas, ka, ja runā par maksātnespējas reformu, ja amatpersonas statusu Saeima ceturtdien tomēr noņems administratoriem, tad es uzskatu, ka reforma ir izgāzusies kopumā, jo tādā gadījumā likums tiks nodots otrreizējai caurlūkošanai. Vēl noteikti ir jāmin tas, ka tiesiskās aizsardzības procesā mēs piekritām investoru padomes priekšlikumam un turpmāk kreditori varēs izvēlēties paši personu, kuri īsteno tiesiskās aizsardzības procesu, un šī persona varēs arī nebūt amatpersona, ja kreditori par to vienosies. No 18. gada 1. janvāra arī maksātnespējas procesā ir paredzēts, ka kreditori varēs izvēlēties brīvajā tirgu šo maksātnespējas procesu uzraugu vai no auditoriem vai zvērinātiem revidentiem vai citas jomas speciālistiem. Protams, arī palielināsim administrācijas pilnvaras, un administrātor turpmāk varēs maksātniskais administrācijas ierēģi, turpmāk varēs ierasties jebkura administrātora prakses vietā un veikt negaidītu iepriekš nepieteiktu pārbaudi par viņu lietuvībā esošiem dokumentiem un par maksātnespējas procesu gaidu. Nu, svarīgākais padarītais, protams, ir elektroniskās izsoles. Elektroniskās izsoles nekustamā īpašuma izsoļa procesā, ēna ekonomikas mazināšanas pasākuma, pamatā skaidrs naudas darbības, skaidrā nauda ierobežojumi, tiesa teritoriālā reforma, tātad viens tiesa apgabals, Latgales tiesa apgabals šai reformai jau ir pakļauts un tajā ir īstenota, un tā reforma tiks līdz Latvijas simtgadē pabeigta. Līdz ar to daudz mazu tiesu vietā būs visi maz uz pusi, ja ne trīs reizes mazās tiesu skaits, šīs tiesas būs lielākas, katrā tiesā būs vairāk tiesneši un būs iespēja ievērot gan specializācijas, gan nejošības principu. Ja runājam par komerci likumu, tad šeit mēs sadarbībā ar ekonomikas ministriju vēl mums ir daudz darāmā un te arī pēc speciālu ieteikumiem mēs pilnveidosim tieši komerci likumu un tiesisko vidi, kas skar akciju sabiedrību. Par apmācībām jau minēju, tātad uzsveru policistu tiesnešu prokuroru apmācībā mēs vēlētos veikt tieši uz ekonomisko un finanšu noziegumu apkarošanu, jo, teiksim, atklāti policijas akadēmijas likvidēšana pirms vairākiem gadiem ir atstājusi rezultātu šīs dienas policijas darbā un ne tikai policijas darbā. Un mums tas ir jāaizpild un Eiropas Savienības sociālais fonda līdzekļi, tam ir 7 gadu garumā, un viens no virzieniem tieši ir šī zināšana paaugstināšana gan izmeklētājiem, gan prokuroriem, gan tiesnešiem. Un visbeidzot, protams, mediācijas institūts, tas arī attīstās, un šeit ir ļoti aktīvi projekti, tieši pagaidām gan ģimenes tiesībās vairāk. Bet mēs gribam izvērsties tieši arī komercdarbības mediācijā īpaši, un te no visas četras uzņēmēju organizācijas mums būs nozīmīgs partneris, gan Komercbanka asociācija, tirdzniecības rūpniecības kamera, Ficils un darba devēja konfederācija. Tā kā paldies, un esmu gatavs atbildēt uz jautājumu, un droši vien pēc nākamajiem ziņotājiem.
Paldies, ministra kungs. Ja es varētu mūsu auditoriju lūgt jums definēt, varbūt, trīs galvenos, varbūt, jomas, kuri jūs pieņemsim līdz nākamā gada maijam, kad mēs atkal satiksimies augstākā līmenī, kas ir tās jomas, kur tieslietu ministrija visvairāk koncentrēsies? Kas ir tie punkti, ko mēs varam sagaidīt?
Pirmais un galvenais, protams, ir tas, ko es runāju, ka šobrīd ir Saeimā, kas virzās uz otro un trešo lasījumu, kas kardināli reformē maksātnespējas administratoru uzraudzības sistēmu un kas maksimāli novērš kādu krāpniecisku nelikumīgu darbību veikšanu. Tas ir pirmais un galvenais, bet es rezultātus nevaru solīt maijā. Rezultāti varētu būt nākamā gada nogalē, jo ir vesela vieta ministra kabineta noteikuma, kur būs jāpieņem. Otrs svarīgais virziens, protams, ir tiesu teritoriālā reforma. Šis virziens ir arī attīstībā, un mēs redzam pēc Latgales tiesu apgabala statistikas, kur šī reforma notika, ka praktiski visi tiesu statistikas rādītāji liecina pa labu, ka šī reforma bija veiksmīgs tiesas, darba efektivitātes rādītāji, tātad termiņi, atlikto lietu skaits un tā tālāk, ir ievērām labāk nekā citos tiesas apgabalos. Un trešais svarīgākais ir tas jau, ko Ficils runāja, tātad, bet tas arī būs vēl darba gaitā, tātad šie komerci likumā viss, kas saistīts ar akciju sabiedrību. Un te detalizētāk varētu runāt jau valsts sekretāra vietniece Laila Mediņa, ka viņa bija klāt.
Paldies liels. Jautājumus mēs atstāsim uz pašām beigām, bet es gribētu aicināt arī Juriju Stīnku pastāstīt par ekonomikas ministrijas prioritātēm, varbūt tiešām mēģinam iekļauties kaut kādos sešās minūtēs, lai mēs vēlāk varētu arī uzdot jautājumus.
Thank you. I will do it in English, probably it's easier for most of the participants. First of all, thank you for this service. Thanks to Arvis and Israel. It gives very valuable inputs to government for our future work and decisions. What I take from today's presentation is that Latvia is not a bad place to invest. As we saw, even the investors would recommend their friends and relatives to do it in Latvia. It's member of EU, OECD, it has rule of law, it has relatively low taxes, quite high skilled workers. On the other hand, of course, I heard that, we are average, and this is probably the issue now. We have to compete with other countries, with Estonia, with Lithuania, with Scandinavia, who are, luckily or unfortunately to us, but they are ones of the most advanced countries in the world. In terms of legislation, taxation, and innovations in general. So this is why we need to do more. And what I've heard and what was especially worrying for me, and I think it's not the first year, it's being said that we're not fulfilling our promises. It's not that we are not doing a lot of things, but that obviously we are promising more than we are able to deliver, or we are not defining the right priorities and failing to prioritize them in the right order, and also to concentrate resources in the right directions. And this is what we in the Ministry of Economy see as the main challenge and the main objective for year to come, is to try to really define those activities and to define them very completely, which we can implement during the next year, and this then we can account for. We talk about those things, and I think that they coincide in a lot of ways with those main areas which Pixel has identified. Of course, it's the supply of labor. I have mixed feelings about democracy. I think it's an extremely important issue for Latvia, but let's not expect that from demography we will get enough for our economy to develop in the same way as it does now. I've talked to, for example, Estonian colleagues, and they have exactly the same problem. There is a lack of labor, basically the way out is just two ways. First, we need to become more productive. We need to do more with the existing labor. We need to restructure economy and do those things which are more value added. And the second thing which we can look at is how to reform our education, and also the education for those people who are already in the labor market, to try to move on towards those areas where there is a lack of labor in the market, because we see that there is a quite big imbalance what are the people coming out of educational institutions and what are the labor requirements. And the third thing which we as the Ministry of Economy are looking at is the smart immigration concept, which would mean that we try to attract not everybody, but high-skilled people to Latvia. It's mainly three directions. One is the traditional, when the company is already working here, cannot find adequate professionals in Latvia, they can look outside. The other is that we have more and more foreign students studying in Latvia, so after they finish their studies, they currently have to leave because the possibilities prolong, the permits are quite complicated. And the third thing is we see that we can attract investors who are creating new companies here in Latvia. It's the concept that the Ministry of Economy is also moving forward with this startup promotion. We think also that people from other countries could choose Latvia as a place where to start their business. We have on those things very concrete proposals to the immigration law, which we are proposing for Ministry of Economy, and also what we can do with the labor market. We can and we are already working with the separate areas of economy to define very precisely where do we lack the people. Then we talk about the environment of business in Latvia. Of course, we see this doing business index, which is very positive this year. We have 14th in the world, but of course, it's not enough because Estonia, I think, is somewhere in the top 10 already. So the one direction is the taxation policy, which is also according to FISO, one of the problematic areas. What we see is that they also try to copy a little bit what Estonians are doing, and one of the ways they are looking at is that for the small business they would create a zero bureaucracy, which would mean combine both legislation and IT solutions in a way that you as a small taxpayer just have to put all your incomes into one bank account, and from there the state deducts in Estonian case 20%, and this is all you have to comply with. Those are all your requirements from the State Revenue Service. And they are looking also at other categories. Yeah, so that this is where we look at, and then one big area which is a direct responsibility of economy, Ministry of Economy, construction. We have to reduce administrative burden and do it very fast and radically. We are with the Ministry of Justice on this insolvency reform. And then, of course, we as a country need to do everything we can to ensure that all EU funds that are available for Latvia are provided to the business and being used properly. That's very short. Thank you.
Okay, if may I just summarize, so that the areas is construction law, I understand, that the smart migration and demography is the sort of a long-term topic. Startup legislation and the ways how to use basically smart people in terms of pushing the innovation and have I missed anything?
And yes, the financial things which be the funds and other okay. ways how to attract finance.
Okay, and smart use of the digital funds for the business community. Okay, thank you, Juris. I think the audience is probably preparing the question. Imas, now it's back to you. Tax has been mentioned as an issue for a while. I think this time the tax system is actually seems to increase the uncertainty, overall uncertainty in terms of many foreign investors. So what from the Ministry of Finance, what you could say to us in terms of what we should expect next?
Okay. Okay, thank you. Thank you, Zlatko. Thank you, Fritzl, for inviting, and also thank you, Mr. Salto, for this excellent presentation. Firstly, I would say that also this report is an excellent example of new economy, whole British economy. And when we see that actually you produced report themselves, and it's like modern technologies. It's better than Facebook and Twitter, I think. And also, I will not report repeat the good points that was mentioned by the Minister of Justice and also State Secretary of the Minister of Economy, and start maybe with some things with the budget. At the beginning, maybe I want to say is that, of course, the critics are very important, but it's important not to get depressed after receiving critics, but to find solutions, better solutions, to work further. And on promises and taxes and budget, I think this year budget, the promise from Minister of Finance was not to increase main taxes and to work with the issues that were already on the table, not to find new priorities. And this was done. No of the main taxes was increased, and the priorities that was financed by this budget actually was the same that was already done also previous year, what was in the different approaches of government, namely healthcare, education, internal security, defense. All this was priorities that was increased finance last year, and it will be increased next year in the medium term as well. And it's worth to mention that almost all other sectors got no increase in expenditure or even decreased. It means that the budget is prioritized. And what else can we say on the plans from Minister of Finance? Of course, the first work that we already are in is the tax policy strategy. And it's promised by government to get this strategy by 1st of April, say at the end of the first quarter. We are already quite deep in this issue for more than 1 year. Additional, and we discussed especially all this historical part of this and what to do. But the main decisions are still in front of us. This was also. And this was also one of the reasons that was said by Minister of Finance not to say increase bigger taxes this year, as we need time to discuss this, we need time to analyze, and need time also to agree with us. As there are different stakeholders for budget, for tax policy, of course tax and taxpayers also are not the same, and the interests are sometimes very, very different. Especially when we go through tax allowance, it's a classical academic example that to get rid of any tax allowance is very hard because the people or companies or group who receives this tax allowance are very strong to defend, and the group who will get better off when this tax allowance are reduced or eliminated are better off very, very small, by very, very small amounts, so they are not very mobile. And so we get a lot of very specific tax allowances that are eroding our budget revenues, but maybe not bringing the best possible solution to the whole economy, to the whole society. And what are the goals for tax policy? It's a different one. Of course, business environment is always one of primary goals. But additionally, we should understand that budget is an instrument of redistribution of our wealth, of our GDP. And it's agreed also with the business community that taxes should distribute at least, not at least, but 1/3 of GDP. Now it's 30%, say it increased by 2-3 percentage points from in the medium term, it's not said that tomorrow. And it's quite challenging. Of course, there is a lot of possibilities to get this result tax increases, like better tax administration, great economy. But also the same as the situation I mentioned with these old tax allowances is crucial as well. And maybe one thing I also want to mention is there was also mentioned about this tax uncertainty. But sometimes we produce this uncertainties themselves when we ignore actually the work and ignore sustainability. A good example is microenterprise tax. The situation we are now, we were knowing actually not the last year, not the not this year. It's the situation that there is a need to be reformed actually emerge after 2-3 years of this when this regime was introduced, but there was no enough understanding also without with all the stakeholders how to reform it and why to reform it. And so we need now get a quite bigger cut than it would be done say 3 years ago. So that's from my side.
Okay, thank you very much. We have heard about the priorities of each of the ministries, and I would like to open the floor to the discussion and questions to the panelists in terms of what do you expect, maybe your wishes, maybe your questions about the priorities. Okay. I just wonder whether there are someone else who would like to answer, because otherwise we are sort of I will leave you to the last point. Colleagues, any other question? Yeah,
one of the government's priorities is to attract new investment, and government is spending resources like an investment building, traveling around the world. In the report which has been presented this today, we saw that half of the investors question are ready to continue investment in Latvia. I would like to ask panelists, each of the ministry representatives, what might be your actions to encourage current investments, investors continuing investment in Latvia?
Sākuma ziņojumā es varu tikai ieteikt citām ministrijām darīt tāpat, kā mēs izdarījām. Aiciniet vismaz reizi gadā OECD vēstniekus un atskaitieties, sniedziet pārskatu par paredzamajām reformām un iecerētajiem darbiem, jo tā investīcija vide, kas nāk no OECD valstīm, protams, es nenolīdzu arī citas investīcijas, arī spēcīgas, bet tomēr tā ir investīcija jau jaunai tiesiskajai telpai un cita līmeņa attīstībai. Ko es vienmēr starptautiskos fórumos arī uzsveru, un ko varbūt daudzi investori un varbūt arī atsevišķās situācijas diplomātiskais korpuss nezinu, Latvija vēl 1938. Gadā bija 10. Attīstītākā Eiropas valsts pēc iekšzemes koprodukta uz vienu iedzīvotāju, 10. Attīstītākā starp Baltijas valstīm pārliecinoši pirmā. Un, protams, ka 50 gadu okupācija mums ir atmetusi atpakaļ, kur mēs esam, un tagad mūsu uzdevums ir radīt tādu vidi, lai mēs nonāktu vismaz to, kur mēs bijām, un tas ir Eiropas valsts pirmajā desmitniekā. Tas ir vietas vidēja līmeņa. Un es vienkārši iesaku arī citām ministrijām, ne tikai ārlietu ministrijai darīt to pašu, aicināt investorus biežāk darba grupās iesaistīt investoru padomus cilvēkus un ciešāk veidot šo sadarbību.
I will share my personal experience because I am in the Ministry of Economy just from May. Before that, I was working for an international company who was present in the whole world. And when I talk to my colleagues And you try to compare the when you try to compare the environment in Baltic states, you could not really find that many differences. But the general perception was that Latvia, Estonia and Lithuania is much better, because in Latvia you have corruption, you have inefficient state institutions and so on. What I want to say is that we need to also think how we present our country. We need to do something about the relations, communications with investors. We need to do more about being a country as a service for entrepreneurs. Which doesn't mean that we don't need to do concrete things to improve our environment, but if we have a chance to go to Estonia and instantly see in all the government institutions how perfectly they present their country. Not always this is that much better, but it looks fantastic. And the one concrete thing which we plan to do in the Ministry of Economy is to develop contact points for foreign investors and also for local investors, so that we could deal efficiently, more efficiently with their particular issues. Thank you.
From my side, I can just add, of course, short-term job is the increased tax certainty through tax strategy that will be developed and hopefully also accepted by government, and also is a big involvement of all stakeholders, including FITSO. And part of this is not just taxes, but all the budget structure as quality of expenditure, administrative burden, and such things that we should do this medium-term plan. And find what we can do first, and second, let's say in 5 years, the certainty about the things that will change.
Thank you very much. Yep, there is a question.
Yes, Minister. 16 izstrādāt efektīvi instrumenti inovāciju aizsardzībai, inovāciju pieviešanai visās 118 pašvaldībās. Galvenokārt tāpēc arī Latvijas attīstības komisijas. Ir instrumenti, kur varētu ātri atrisināt šos jautājumus, viena ministrija pārstāvja otrai un iesniedz.
Paldies par jautājumu. Man šķiet, ka instruments sēž zālē. Patentu valdes vadītājs. Ir uz vietas, vai? Tad mēs ar mūsu patentu valdes gadu lepojamies. Ir nu? Ja kurā gadījumā tie līdzekļi, kas ir mūsu rīcībā, pamatā tā ir patentu valde. Un, protams, savā ziņā arī uzņēma reģistrs. Bet šeit, protams, ir kompetenci sadalsts ar primministriju, kas šeit ir pārstāvēts.
Ekonomikas ministrija negrib dokumentēt par inovācijām. Varbūt mazāk par inovāciju aizsardzību, cik vairāk par inovāciju politiku un kādā veidā atbalstīt.
Jā, par inovāciju politiku, protams, mēs gribam būt inovatīva valsts un mēs gribam sasniegt lielāku ieguldījumu ekonomikā, inovāciju jomā, bet, protams, arī skaidrs tas, ka ekonomikas ministrija nekā cita ministrija neinovēs ekonomiku. Tas ir pašu uzņēmumu uzdevums un tas, uz ko ekonomikas ministrija un izglītības ministrija šobrīd koncentrējās, uz to, kā radīt šo saisti starp uzņēmējiem un pētniekiem un izglītības sistēmu, nodrošināt to, ka šīta mūsu pētniecības un izglītības kapacitāte atbilst tam, ko uzņēmējiem nepieciešams.
Un nu, pamatā viss šis process ir ietverts Eiropas Savienības finansējumus, tādā veidā šis te fondu programmas tiek veidotas un īstenotas, lai uzliktu akcentus praktisko inovāciju. To, ko mēs darām pētniecības jomā un izglītības jomā, tas arī nonāk ir tā lielākā problēma.
Paldies!
Es atvainojos, ministra kungs, es gribētu turpināt galvenā doma ir tā, lai ministrijas paši iesaistītos. Protams, jums ir patentēt izstrādāt. Diemžēl 180 pašvaldības nav vienākas. Vietām ir, kur ir augstītelēks, un viņi seko ministrija lēmumiem. Ir pat tādi gadījumi, ka ministrija lēmumi ir, bet mums jau viena logika. Tā kā liekas, tieši varbūt ekonomikas ministrija tieši būtu atbildīgāk, nevis tā kā vides ministrija ir kā par pašvaldībām atbild. Un ekonomikas ministrija neatbildīgāk. Patiesībā jau vajadzētu būt tieši ekonomikas ministrijas tāda virsvadība, ko mums ierosinās no Latvijas mākslinieks dizainās. Paldies!
Paldies! Premjera pārraudzībā ir 21 dažādi padomi, kur ir dažādas horizontālas struktūras un viena ir tāda atbildība. Ja? Ir noziedzības novēršanas padomē, tautsēmniecības padomē, un viena no šiem ir, ja nemaldos, inovācijas padomi. Turpat, un jāsaka, ka te tas līderis spēlētājs ir pārrobežu koordinācijas centrs, bet es saku, ka ekonomikas ministrija arī nav maza loma. Tā ka tie jautājumi nav vienas ministrijas kompetences. Tie visi ir premjera pārziņā, un te ir bijusi premjera, viņi zina, cik daudz viņai padomas bija jāvada un cik sarežģītie jautājumi, kur ir vienlaikus pat līdz 10 ministrijām iesaistīts vienu jautājumu atrisināšanā. Piemēram, šobrīd, ja runājam par informācijas tehnoloģijām, tad tur ir gandrīz katra ministrija praktiski, kas ir sarka.
Dear foreign investors, any other questions from the audience?
Hello, I'm Slavkovics from Kavangelis. My question is for the representative of the finance ministry. I had the privilege of conducting 5 or 6 of the interviews for this report, and what I recall from my interviewees, main concern was unfair competition due to the shadow economy in regard to evasion of taxes or schemes to evade taxes. Can you tell us what in 12 years, 12 months time from now, when we meet again for another review of the situation of investor sentiments, what will have occurred as far as deterring individuals and complex groups of VAT schemers and cash register fraudsters? What will have occurred in 12 months to deter these kinds of actions and to provide some kind of fear of enforcement, actual enforcement? Because the problem is that people and these scheming groups are not deterred because there seems to be no enforcement. And then those that are caught, it seems there's no effective prosecution or penalizing. That's my question. Thank you.
Thank you. The fight with the economy is a high on government agenda. Actually, even next week will be called the Grey Economy Fighting Council by Prime Minister. We organized as well. And we have adopted this year a plan how to fight the Grey Economy. And a part of that plan is already in the budget 2017. With the measures saying such industries like construction, and the measure is not a big industry but also a very grave industry like taxis in industry. And also we have many measures that are, say, horizontal, like measures that is dealing with cash in economy, measures dealing with the cash register, as I mentioned. When you ask what will be different in 12 months, First, I hope we will get the understanding how it works, these measures by sectors. Is there a real change in construction with these new measures? And if not, why? If yes, how we could do these things further to the other sectors to identify this, say, main sources of the great economy. But when you're also talking on this prosecution and on legal systems, I think it's a work that could not be done overnight. It's involved also many institutions, including general prosecutor's office, the courts and so on. But there also we see that the improvements are coming, and slowly we got a new director for State Revenue Service. Is a quite priority, especially on great economy and on, say, on West Tax Burden, and this could on administrative burden, and these are two issues that should work together.
Thank you very much. Investors, colleagues, more questions?
Thank you. I understand in about 5 months the energy sector gas is going to be decoupled. I understand it's around early April. Can you tell us something about the actionable plan for this decoupling, and how long do you think it will take to complete this decoupling? And one other item about the demographic situation. It seems like there's a tendency to say that this is a long-term problem and therefore take away from the critical issue here in Latvia. But clearly the situation is in a downward spiral. And it's going to be very difficult to change a downward spiral. All physicists could easily attest to that, because there are many, many factors that are working against the reversal of the situation. I won't go into detail, but I think everybody's aware of it. So I suggest very strongly that this issue should not be relegated to long term, but to immediate present danger.
So I understand there are two questions actually. One is about the demography, and the other is about the liberalization of the gas market.
So timeline for the gas market liberalization is following the new company which will be operating the distribution will be created as of 1st of January. Then 1st of April is the liberalization of market, which would mean that other providers can access freely markets, and our consumers can use this gas. And until the end of next year, this current owners of Latvijas Gāze have to sell their shares in this distribution company. So that's basically the timeline. We are currently working on the necessary legislative act. The other thing, of course, which is more complicated, is the creation of regional gas market together with other Baltic countries, which then something similar to what we have now in the electricity markets with the open market and with market prices. But we're working on this as well. On the democracy, demography, I can only agree with you. I can only agree with you that it's a priority which needs to be dealt with immediately. What I wanted to say in my speech is that let's not hope that in a few years we will get from that immediate influence on the labor market. It's not our solution for at least medium term.
Par demogrāfiju arī, tā ir arī viena no premjeras padomēm, demogrāfijas premjeras padomēm, un tur viena no galvenajiem atbildīgajiem ministriem ir labklājības ministrija. Bet jāsaka, katrai no ministrijas savu uzdevumu, es jau minēju, tie mūsējie uzdevumi, protams, ir Ir mēs esam panākuši, ka valsts garantētie uzturlīdzekļi nākamā gada 1. septembrī būs bērniem, kas mācās līdz 21. gada vecumā, nevis kā līdz 18. kā ir tagad. Vēl viena lieta ir arī saņemt finansējums, kā ir personas, kuras stājas laulībā, vai jau ir stājušās laulībā, varētu saņemt speciālu papildus apmācību, un mēs redzam, ka cilvēki izvēlās tieši finanšu un budžetu plānošanu ģimenē, ja, kas ir ļoti svarīga lieta arī kopīgā demogrāfijas politikā. Un vēl var minēt arī to, ka, protams, dzimstībā pakāpenis, bet tomēr Latvijā pieaug, arī tie rādītāji pieejami publiski. Jāsaka, tas budžets, kas ir 17. Gadam pieņemts un arī vidējā termiņā 3 gadiem, ka tas budžets vien no prioritātēm ir demogrāfija šajā valdībā.
Paldies. Colleagues, any other questions to any of the ministers? Okay. Maybe the question from me would be to Ministry of Finance. We know that there was a study performed by the World Bank in terms of the potential sort of areas of the tax reform needed. So I understand that by 1st of April there is a plan to come to certain tax reform. Maybe you could give us a little bit more of the information, which taxes will be affected, where do you see would be the real biggest changes, where we as a foreign investors could actually see the real changes, and because we need to plan our businesses as well.
Yes, thank you for the question. Of course, I cannot answer now very precisely because the discussions, as I said, are still we are still in the process of discussions. But the idea is to discuss the whole map of taxes, not one in particular, but where we are expecting the main discussions. Of course, a taxation of capital and taxation of labor, and say to fulfill two goals. First, of course, to be attractive for investments and for business. Second, to reduce income inequality. Say it's progressivity question of labor income taxation. And third, last but not the least question is how to finance it. If these funds out say revenue negative, say lower taxation, say, or bigger allowances, say progressivity. As I mentioned, then things where we are looking for is of course first the tax administration, the economy. But we should look also broader, say, allowances in all taxes, including also this one I mentioned, and also taxation of, say, goods, taxation of services, different as a financing. But this discussion are still open, and one thing also next week on 14th of December, there is organized taxpayer forum. I hope that many of your companies also got the invitation to this forum. And one of the main topics of this discussion also will be this medium-term tax policy by Minister of Finance. Also, we will get quite good information also from our partners like World Bank, OECD, European Commission, as you from outside, as you from like also ideas that we could discuss, accept or not accept, it also depending on our decisions.
Thank you very much. Colleagues, questions? Alright. If there is no questions, I would like just to summarize that we with all the presentation of ours regarding our sentiment index. I think what is positive is that at least half of the foreign investors are planning to invest in Latvia. Therefore, it is very important for lawmakers actually to really fulfill the obligations or the commitments which we have agreed before. I think it is important as well for those investors who are not yet decided whether to invest in Latvia or not, that the structural reform, tax reform, law enforcement, reform in the legal system, smart migrations are tackled. So thank you very much. I think today we heard a lot of information what will be done, and I think this name, when we usually organize our high council of foreign investors, we could actually try to look back and probably see whether the progress in the areas which we have discussed today, we will see it, and be very honest to ourselves as a foreign investors and to our partners from the government in evaluation of this progress. So thank you very much.